March 30th, 1942. 1,049 bombers depart their bases in England for Germany. Their target? The city of Cologne, Nazi Germany's fourth most populous city. It's the first 1,000 bomber attack in history and an enormous gamble by Arthur Harris, Chief of Bomber Command. Every frontline squadron and most training formations have been mustered for the attack. Heavy losses among the training units could ruin Bomber Command. However, a major success tonight would demonstrate the destructive potential of a huge RAF bombing force and secure the future of the command. In order to overwhelm the German radar-based defenses and deliver the attack on Cologne in only 90 minutes, Harris has concentrated his aircraft into a bomber stream, 30 miles wide and 150 miles long. The frontline squadrons have been concentrated in the front and rear of the formation, while the operational training squadrons, filled with instructors and pupil crews, are to be spread in the middle of the formation. Facing the bomber stream are Germany's radar night defenses. This begins at the coast with a series of dark fighting positions, each named after an animal. These positions were originally operated on the Freya AN method, where a long-range Freya radar attempted to both track an incoming bomber and guide a night fighter to within visual range. The system required expert ground controllers, and thus successful interceptions were uncommon. By the spring of 1942, a new system with more precise but shorter-range giant Wurzburg radars was being implemented. Now the Freya acted as a long-range early warning radar, warning of the approach of bombers so a night fighter could scramble to take up patrol in a night fighting position. When within range, the Freya directed a giant Wurzburg to take over tracking of the bomber while the second Wurzburg tracked the night fighter. Information from the radars were used to plot the position of the bomber and fighter on a map table, with which ground controllers guided the night fighters to within visual range of the bomber. The potential of this system was further enhanced by the arrival of the first airborne intercept radars that could be mounted on German night fighters. Now the night fighter only needed to be guided to within several kilometers range of the bomber, whereupon the onboard radar could be used to guide the night fighter the rest of the way. Increasingly, the dark fighting method was proving to be the most effective system of nighttime interception. Behind the coastal dark fighting positions are the searchlight illuminated fighting positions, codenamed by numbers and letters. These positions operated similarly to the dark fighting positions, however, radar-guided searchlights assisted in illuminating the bomber for the attacking night fighter. However, on cloudy nights, the searchlights could not illuminate the bombers through the clouds, and RAF bomber pilots often dove their planes through these positions, thus complicating interceptions. For various reasons, the searchlights had started to be withdrawn from these positions, and the illuminated zones were becoming dark fighting zones. The final line of defense are the combined night fighting zones, where flak, fighters, and searchlights all work together to defend key German cities from the bombers. In theory, German night fighters assigned to these combined zones engage bombers flying above a certain altitude, while flak only engage targets below a certain altitude. In practice, the German flak batteries often exceed their allotted altitude, sometimes shooting down and killing German night fighter pilots. Nevertheless, the combined defenses take a toll on the bombers that enter these zones. Well, formidable, this defensive system has one major weakness. Each night fighting position can only track one bomber and guide one night fighter at a time. This has not previously been a problem. Previously, RAF bombers had plotted their own routes to and from the target, making them easy prey for the German defenses. By 1942, however, Allied intelligence has recognized this weakness and Bomber Command plans to counter it with their bomber stream tactic. By concentrating their bombers into a narrow stream, only a few night fighting positions will be entered by British bombers, and those that are will be swamped with far too many targets for a single fighter to effectively engage. So far, the new tactic appears to be working. As the front of the bomber stream reaches Cologne, almost no bombers have yet been shot down. Attacking in the first wave are the G-equipped Stirlings and Wellingtons of No. 1 and 3 Group. G is the RAF's first radio navigation device, allowing RAF bombers to accurately navigate at night. It's a task of the G-equipped aircraft to begin fires that will guide the rest of the bombers to the target area. Leading the way are Wing Commander McDonald and Squadron Leader Gilmore, 15 Squadron, two experienced pilots specifically chosen to mark the aiming point with their incendiaries. They find the defenses seemingly unprepared, with ineffective flak greeting their arrival. Thanks to the full moon, they easily locate the aiming point, the Neumarkt, located in Cologne's ancient city center. As the wires on the bombsite cross, the bombers release their mix of incendiaries on the aiming point below. and is quickly joined by more loads from the following aircraft, the first of 1.5 million pounds of explosives and incendiaries dropped by these bombers. In order to destroy as much of Cologne as possible, the bombardiers are instructed to bomb areas which are not yet burning. By now, the defenses have woken up, and heavy flak and searchlight activity is encountered by the bombers. A wing commander from a Wellington squadron states, "We saw many fires which had not yet taken real hold, but I thought it had all the markings of a successful raid. It was easy enough to see the city, for we could pick out the Rhine and the bridges quite clearly. There was little or no opposition over target, I think because there were so many aircraft the ground defenses could not cope with them. Before I left, I saw the fires growing larger and larger." As the fires take hold in Cologne, bomber crews still crossing the coast begin to notice a red glow on the horizon. By now, the German defenses were beginning to awaken, and RAF bombers heading for Cologne began to fall to German night fighters and flak. Some bombers opt to bomb Essen instead. As the first wave clears Cologne and heads home, the second wave, comprised of the non-G-equipped bombers of 1st and 3rd groups, the twin-engine bombers of 4th and 5th groups, and the training units of 91st and 92nd training groups, begin their bomb runs. While the remaining 1st and 3rd group bombers aim for the Neumarkt, the bombers of 5th group and 91st training group are given an aiming point 1 mile to the south, centered on Cologne's Volksgarten. The bombers of 4th and 92nd training group are given an aiming point 1 mile north, centered on Cologne's main rail yard. As the groups drop another 900,000 pounds of ordnance on Cologne, Flight Sergeant Eddie Wheeler flying an OTU Wellington recalls, "Many aircraft above us with their bomb doors open revealed stocks of bombs which, when released, were more than likely to land on aircraft below. At the point of release, there were showers and showers of incendiaries and HEs passing us on all sides. It seemed like one sea of flame on the ground, and I felt sick for the poor devils below and the terrors they must be experiencing." Leaving Cologne, the bombers turn south and lose height in order to gain speed and exit the target area faster. Making the final turn for home, the bomber stream begins to spread out as each crew plots their own route back to base. As the bomber stream begins to disperse, the concentration that protected the bombers on the flight to Cologne begins to lose effectiveness, and increasing numbers of RAF bombers fall victim to German night fighters. Flying in Cologne's combined fighting zone, codenamed Colibri, Oberleutnant Bokemeyer and his radio operator, Unterfeldwebel Lachmann, engage the RAF bombers as they leave the target area. "Around 1:21 hours, I saw an enemy bomber of the Halifax type in the moonlight. After I received the order to attack, I slowly got myself below and behind the hostile plane and, after the rear gunner opened fire on me, shot at his turret. The enemy aircraft nosed steeply down. I pushed the stick forward likewise and fired several bursts in the ensuing combat. I observed burning in his fuselage, then he dropped over into a dive. At this point, my operator changed the drum magazines, and suddenly I saw a twin-engine aircraft right by the Halifax. Although I again put the nose down, I lost sight of the Halifax. Suddenly, at 200 meters, I saw an enemy aircraft ahead of me. I immediately got control of my plane and fired into the starboard wing route from behind and below with all guns. Right after the first shot, I was dazzled by a flash of flames. At 1:43 hours, while orbiting in search of the hostile plane, I saw the impact fire beneath me. The bright moonlight this evening, necessary for the RAF bombers to locate Cologne, also makes the bombers quite visible to expert German night fighters. 18-kill ace Reinhold Kanaka, patrolling position 5C, shoots down three bombers this night, while 26-kill ace Werner Streib, patrolling position 5B, shoots down two bombers. Six other Luftwaffe pilots managed to shoot down two bombers each this night, including future ace Heinrich Prinz zu Sien Wittgenstein, who adds his second and third kills to his tally, a tally that would eventually reach 83 aircraft, almost all bombers. By now, the second wave of bombers have cleared Cologne, and the third wave, made up of the four-engine heavy bombers of 4 and 5 group, begin their bomb run. 109 Halifaxes head for the northern aiming point centered on the rail yard, while 68 Lancasters head for the southern aiming point around the Volksgarten. They carry with them 1.1 million pounds of high explosives and incendiaries, and are allotted the final 15 minutes to bomb, though some arrive as much as 20 minutes ahead of schedule. As the RAF heavies begin their bomb run, they encounter much reduced flak over the target area. This welcoming development for the bomber crews is in fact the result of a major miscommunication within the German defenses. Expecting the arrival of German night fighters over Cologne, the flak batteries reduce their rate and height of fire so as to prevent any friendly fire incidents. However, the night fighters never received the order to take off for Cologne. Thus, the German defenses weaken at the moment the RAF's most powerful bombers begin their bomb run. Among the ordnance that rains down on Cologne are the massive 4,000-pound high-capacity bombs carried by the Lancasters. These blast bombs, of which three-quarters of the weight is explosive filler, in conjunction with a full load of incendiaries, allows each Lancaster to lay waste to 10 acres of target area. The Halifax, which cannot carry such a massive bomb, can destroy only 6 acres with its mix of 1,000-pound bombs and incendiaries. One Halifax pilot flying over Cologne recounts, "So vast was the burning that ordinary fires on the outskirts of the city or outside it, which I should usually have described as very big, looked quite unimportant. It was strange to see the flames reflected on our aircraft. It looked at times as though we were on fire ourselves, with the red glow dancing up and down the wings." As the bombers leave Cologne, many crews report the glow of the inferno raging in the target area still visible up to 150 miles away. The crews return to base with reports of a major success this night. However, not all the crews who set out this night return. Some 41 bombers are lost in the raid. The Luftwaffe's Abschusskommission, shootdown commission, will award 14 of these kills to the flak arm, while 27 kills are credited to 17 successful night fighter pilots. Another 19 bombers crash in England, either due to battle damage or accidents. In total, some 28 RAF crewmen are killed, and another 230 are listed as missing, many who will be later confirmed as dead when their bodies are pulled from the wreckage of their bombers. While costly, the loss of 41 bombers over enemy territory represents only 3.8% of the attacking force, a sustainable loss rate for Bomber Command, and an improvement over the 4.6% loss rate averaged in prior raids on similar targets. The training units, which have been committed to reach the important 1,000 bomber milestone, suffer below average losses of only 3.1%. Thus, Bomber Command's expansion would not be interrupted as would have occurred had these training units suffered heavy losses. The bomber stream tactic had proved its worth and would become the standard method with which Bomber Command would attack German targets going forward. In response, the Luftwaffe would begin to construct more and more night fighting positions throughout the continent so that more night fighters could be massed against the bomber stream. The attack on Cologne was the deadliest bombing raid Nazi Germany had so far suffered since the war began. Though the death toll was surprisingly low given the scale of the attack, that was little consolation for those who lost loved ones. Some 469 people in Cologne lost their lives on the night of May 30th, 31st. They're listed as one police officer, 18 civil defense police, 8 members of the civil defense unit number 27, 58 members of the German armed forces, and 384 civilians. Another 531 people required hospitalization, and 4,467 required first aid. The damage to Cologne is also severe. Bomber Command estimates that some 600 acres of Cologne having been completely destroyed. German records list damage to 41,640 dwelling units, such as apartments or flats, with 13,010 completely destroyed, 6,360 badly damaged, and 22,270 slightly damaged. Some 45,132 city residents were thus bombed out of their homes and needed accommodation elsewhere, and an estimated 135,000 citizens of Cologne fled in the aftermath of the raid. Of factories and industrial installations specifically, 36 were completely destroyed with the loss of 100% of production, 70 were badly damaged with 50 to 80% loss of production, and 222 sustained medium or slight damage with less than 50% of production. Rail traffic through the city was temporarily halted due to the damage, and 4 main dock areas for barges on the River Rhine suffered severe damage. Despite the seemingly impressive damage, Cologne would in fact rapidly recover from the raid, and by the end of 1942, almost all the important war industry in Cologne had been rebuilt and the population rehoused. Bomber Command, in comparison, due to various operational and technical limitations, would be unable to repeat their success at Cologne on other German cities for the remainder of the year. Thus, the 1,000 bomber raid on Cologne was Bomber Command's singular success for 1942. Nevertheless, Arthur Harris had made his point. Securing the continued expansion of Bomber Command and laying the groundwork for a force that would devastate German military and civilian targets in the following years. On the night of June 29th, 1943, almost 13 months to the day of the 1,000 bomber raid, residents of Cologne would see the ominous sight of red flares falling through the clouds over their city. These target markers were in fact the harbinger of the improved Bomber Command, forged from the success of the 1,000 bomber raid on this very city. Equipped with more heavy bombers and an advanced suite of electronic navigation and targeting aids, Bomber Command had by mid-1943 finally become a force able to consistently deliver devastating raids on German cities. As a red flare settled amongst the streets below on the night of June 29, 1943, the roar of the engines of 600 approaching bombers heralded for Cologne death and destruction on a scale that would dwarf what 1,000 bombers had inflicted on it during that spring evening in May 1942.